creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west. All right, good morning, church family. What an awesome day it is to be here this morning. I know we arrive at church on a Sunday in late November, and it's a little, or mid-November, it's a little chillier than we expected for this time of year, but it's a good day to be inside in the warm with the opportunity to worship our God today. And I believe that we have a great day in store as we go before the Lord. So today, first and foremost, we want to thank you once again for being here, but also if you're visiting with us today, we want to invite you to take that Connect card. It's on the back of your pew. Take a moment at some point today during the service to fill that out and then drop it in the offering plate as you go today. So we invite you to do that as well. A little bit later on, for a four-year-old through the third grade, after the final worship song that we do before the sermon today, we are beginning to offer a children's church for 4 years old through the third grade. I know we tested that a little bit earlier this year, and we're going to start offering that on a week-to-week basis, so those four-year-old through the third grade can be a part of that. We'll dismiss a little bit later on in our service for that as well. If you would, I invite you to stand with me. I'm going to open up our service by going before the Lord like we do each and every week, and then we will begin to worship in song together. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning grateful for who you are, grateful for your faithfulness. And as we say each week, Lord, we are grateful for your mercies that are new each day. Lord, as we come before the throne with hearts of praise, Lord, we do pray that if there would be anything in our hearts that is holding us back of giving you all the glory, all the honor and praise this morning, Lord, may we lay that at your feet this morning. If we need to spend time today, Lord, confessing ways in which we have failed, may we do that as well. But God, we give this time to you. May it be honoring, pleasing, and glorifying to your name. Through song, through the study of your word, through prayer today, may we give our all to you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Let's sing the blessed assurance we have in Christ this morning.
My song, praising my Savior.
because that's our testimony this morning. Let us continue in worship by greeting one another around us. And we encourage you to take some time, meet a new face this morning. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. Continue this morning by singing the name and proclaiming the name of Jesus.
Your name, still call the sea.
longs to see once again. Shadows can't deny your name, cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, let the shadows can't deny. Once again, it says your name is a light that the shadows can't deny.
Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. The darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, your silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Amen. As we continue this morning, this next song we're going to sing talks about God's mercy. And earlier we prayed and talked back to God and spoke back to the Lord about how his mercies are new each day. May this be a proclamation of that, that his mercy is far greater than all of our sin, all of our struggles, all of our shortcomings. Let's proclaim his name in this way this morning.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Would wait as we constantly run. the payment, His life was the cost. We stood beneath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
We proclaim,
praise the
this time to join with me in prayer. Lord, this morning we proclaim who you are. We praise you for who you are. And we worship you because of your goodness, your mercies that are new each day. And as we glorify your name through song, as we glorify your name through the reading of Scripture, as we glorify your name through the study of your word, Lord, we pray that you would be honored in everything that we do today. Lord, may your name be glorified, may your name be praised, but most importantly, God, we do ask that today, if there's anybody here who does not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, we pray that today would be the day of salvation in this place. Would your kindness lead us to repentance this day? It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I invite you to remain standing. If you're 4 years old through third grade, this is an opportunity today for you to be dismissed to a children's church, which we are going to be offering in the coming days. Miss Kathy will be meeting the children right out here over in this back corner over there for those who are interested in that. This is the time each week where we're going to begin dismissing for that. So be on the lookout, not just today, but in the days to come. Miss Kathy will be back there waiting for any kids who want to attend that today. Today, I invite you to remain standing as I read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, our scripture passage for today. This is verses 50 through 58 of 1 Corinthians 15. It says this, "I tell you, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, and in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, 'Death is swallowed up in victory.' O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 through 58. You may be seated.
Praise be the reading of God's word. We are in our fifth sermon on the section of the resurrection. And so specifically, this is talking about our resurrection. And there is the question at hand that the Corinthians were really seeking to handle, which is this. Does the resurrection actually happen? Are we, as humans who are alive, what will happen to those humans? Because if they don't die, how will they be transformed? And then what will happen to the saints who have already died? What is that going to look like? And so there were people in Corinth who were even saying that the resurrection had already taken place. So there were Christians who believed the resurrection of Jesus Christ who would go as far as to say something like this: "We believe in the resurrection and the resurrection of Jesus, but we don't believe in the resurrection of us or humans." So there's just a misunderstanding there then of what's going to happen at the end time, what's going to happen to us. And I've even heard this misunderstanding even mentioned in our church. For instance, someone said to me just in a conversation, they said, "I don't believe in cremation." And I said, "Oh, really? Why don't you believe in cremation?" And they said, "Because how is God going to put that body back together at the resurrection?" Well, you know, that's a fair question or fair point. But to doubt the power of God based upon the resurrection of the dead would not be to have a high enough view of God's power. So I believe that if there were any believers who died when the atom bomb went off over there in Hiroshima, if there are any believers over there, God can raise their body from the dead. And we all know that what happens with an atom bomb going off, there's not ashes that are left behind. Your body disintegrates. Like, literally, it goes into a nothingness. But the reality for us is this: it's not just the believers who are going to be resurrected, the unbelievers will be resurrected as well. You see, we've read John chapter 5, and there's a resurrection for life, and that is for those who believe in Jesus Christ. So when we think about heaven, we always think about a resurrection of life, unto life, a resurrection where we are brought into the pearly gates with God. But there's also a resurrection unto judgment. You see, this is why it's so important for us to share the good news of Jesus Christ with a lost and dying world, because every person who has ever lived is under condemnation, under sin, under judgment, under wrath. And so because of that, we as believers must take this good news of Jesus Christ so that whoever hears may believe. Believe what? In Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ lived the perfect sinless life that you've been called to live. He died the death you deserve to die. So Romans says this: that for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life for those who love him. So that eternal life is this: resurrection from the dead and eternal life in heaven with God because of the work that Jesus did in your life. But there's also a resurrection for those who will go to judgment. And so there, everyone on earth will be resurrected. Everyone who's ever lived will be resurrected. The question at hand is, will you be resurrected to live forever in heaven with God, or will you be resurrected for judgment? So Paul has this text for us. And today we're going to conclude this chapter. We've been really talking about our resurrection in this entire chapter. What does it mean for us to be resurrected? And so we've seen several different principles come through. So in chapter 1, we got to examine four testimonies of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So how we can trust the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because if Jesus rose from the dead, it means that we're going to rise from the dead. We saw next that there are four consequences in believing that there is no resurrection. So if you don't believe in the resurrection, here are some consequences. And we walk through those four consequences on how detrimental it is to not believe in the resurrection. We've seen that there are three implications of the resurrection that impact your daily life. And those happen to be your assurance, your peace, and your strength. And then 2 weeks ago, we saw four pictures that help us understand our resurrection. And those four pictures were this: the picture of death to life seen in a seed. So do you remember that? How when a seed gets planted into the ground, it actually has to die for then life to come out of it. Not only did we see the picture of death to life in a seed, we saw the picture of God's awesome power seen in creation. We saw the picture of God's awesome power seen at redemption, and we saw the picture of life after death seen in Jesus. So today what we're going to examine is this. We're going to examine four realities of the resurrection. So as we are resurrection saints, we believe in the resurrection and the grand display of God's power by providing an empty tomb of Jesus Christ our Lord. Christ's resurrection provides our hope of resurrection. If the resurrection of Jesus is false, and it is not, then our faith is in vain because everything hinges upon the resurrection of Jesus. Paul actually says that we are to be pitied the most for believing in the resurrection of the dead if Jesus did not. Pitied the most. That we are literally cursed, that we are should be despised because we have believed such a lie. So this morning we're going to examine four realities of the resurrection, and I really want to just kind of get really not only practical with four realities of the resurrection for you, but I want us to just have like an honest discussion with the Bible as we walk through this section. And so I know that for all of us, talking about the resurrection is maybe might feel far off. For others, it might feel real close. But I heard this, the greatest preacher that has ever preached, everyone hears his sermon. Babies hear it, old hear it, the young, the old, the rich, the poor, no matter what you do or don't do, all hear the sermon and all fall victim to his sermon. The strongest sermon ever preached is that by death, for all fall to death. So death is coming for all of us. And the longer you live, the more you feel death. Why? Because of the pains. Your body's growing old. You feel the reality that you're not going to live forever. No matter how much money LeBron James invests in his body, he's getting older. And he invests millions of dollars into his body every year. He can't fight death. He can't fight age. None of us can. And so if you are trying to fight time, if you are trying to fight aging, know this. Instead of fighting it, you can embrace it. And you can embrace it because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You can embrace it because of the power of God and what he displayed. And we're going to see that Paul, at the end of this section, what Paul does is he actually puts a display. He actually starts proclaiming to God a praise because of the power of God. He starts proclaiming to God a praise because of what he sees him do, and then he charges the Christian church to then live out their faith. And so my hope for this sermon today and my hope for the previous four is this, that our faith is strengthened to do the will and the work of God because we know that we will be resurrected. We know that there is a life to come, and we know that no matter what happens to our bodies here on earth, whether it's trial or persecution or hardship, no matter what comes our way, no one can take our faith away from us, and our faith in God has secured us for the next life. Amen? So the purpose of this sermon is to examine four realities of the resurrection. The first one is this. It comes from verse 50. It says, you cannot earn heaven. You cannot earn heaven. Look at verse 50 with me. So, we all know that heaven is a free gift for those who believe in Jesus Christ. Verse 50 says this, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does perishable inherit the imperishable. So what do we see here first? That you can't earn heaven. We are bound by flesh and blood. We are bound by perishable. Everything that we do is perishable. Every work that we commit, because our bodies are perishable. So I'm not going to belabor this point, but the reality is this. Many people, I even heard it on the radio this week, that said you can earn heaven by what you do. And I'm like, oh, that's gross misunderstanding of the goodness of God and the grace of God and what heaven is going to be, because by being a good person, that's not in the text. Does it say you can inherit heaven by being a good person? It actually says flesh and blood. So no matter what you do in this body, bound by flesh and blood, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Do you see that? But it also means this. In the body to come, it won't be like the body today. Can I get an amen? Do you guys like your body today? Does it feel good? Let me tell you, I had to call Preston last week because the fallen nature of my body, whether it was a stomach bug or whether it was food poisoning. Can I tell you, we're not going to have stomach bugs or food poisoning in heaven? Praise God. There's not going to be sin. There's not going to be sorrow. There's not going to be pain. There's not going to be suffering. There's not going to be weeping. But can I tell you something? For whatever reason, Jesus ate. Have you ever thought about that? Why do you eat? Because if you don't, you will die, right? If you have an eternal body, is your body dependent upon food? Think about it. So Jesus ate not because his body was dependent upon food, but because he could enjoy food. Hallelujah. That's what I'm talking about. He has an eternal body, but he sat down and he ate some fish. He drank some drink. Why? Just because he could show, in my resurrected body, I can do this. And if he did it in his resurrected body, we can assume that we'll be able to do that in our resurrected body. But we also know this, that when Christ calls his church to himself, there's going to be the marriage supper of the Lamb. At the marriage supper of the Lamb, there's going to be a feast, which means what? Even in our resurrected bodies, we will be eating. It's going to be fantastic. But notice, in our works, we can't inherit heaven because our blood and our flesh, no matter what we do. But also, in this text, we get to see this, that when we have a resurrected body, it's going to be like our body on earth, in the sense that you will still look similar-ish, just like people could recognize Jesus as Jesus, but it's going to be completely different. Because it's not going to be bound by the natural law or the natural order of time like our bodies today. So my first question for you is, are you trying to earn heaven? Are you trying to do enough that God will say, you know, come on, and you deserve it. You gave enough. You attended church enough. Are you trying to earn it? Or do you truly believe that in this moment you're going to, if you died and met Jesus today, you would just say, and God asked you, why should I let you into my heaven? You say, because I believed in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And if that's your belief, that if you just say those words, that he would open up his gates and let you walk in. But if you answer that with any other answer than I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, maybe today you need to place your faith and trust in Jesus. Because notice what it says in the text, verse 50. We're not even have to go further than this. Verse 50, flesh and blood, no matter what you do, cannot inherit heaven. Because you are perishable. You're bound by time. You're bound by the flesh that you have. You're bound by sin in this world. And we need a miracle to happen. So in your heart of heart, are you trying to earn heaven? Or have you already received the greatest gift that the world, has ever been offered? Have you received it? Do you believe? And are you walking with God? So flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. You cannot earn heaven. Eternal life is a gift. Notice the second reality, which is this. To enter heaven, you must be changed. This happens, we get to see this in verses 51 through 53, which say this, if you have your Bibles. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable and will be changed. The dead will be raised imperishable and will be changed. So notice what Paul says. He first starts off by saying, behold. But this is the great change. This is like, now sit on the side, the edge of your chair, because the climax is coming. Here is the reality. There are, Christ will return, and there's going to be his church here. There's going to be believers here on earth. And what's going to happen is this. Those people will never taste death. They'll never taste it. But notice, it's going to say this, behold, we will be changed. So those individuals who are alive, when Jesus comes down on a cloud and he doesn't step foot on earth and he calls the church up to him, this is called the rapture. I have had people tell me that there's not the word rapture in the Bible. Well, that's because it's a Latin word. That's how we get the word rapture. But it's literally comes from this text. It's literally that we'll be transformed. We'll be taken up. We'll be snatched. We will be caught up. That's the rapture. We're caught up. And so what we have here is this. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, we will be changed. Those who are not asleep. But for those who have been asleep, they will be resurrected from the dead. They, maybe because they have 6 feet further to go, will be taken first. They'll be given new bodies. The graves will open, if you will. And they will have a new body, and they will be taken up to God. How does this happen? Paul says it's a mystery. We don't know. Meaning this, it's supernatural. It's a work of God. How is God going to do it? I don't know, but at the same point, I don't need to. I just need to know that he's going to do it. And I need to believe that no matter whether I am dead or alive, when Jesus returns, I will be caught up with him. So notice what this is going to be like. In a twinkling of an eye, in a moment, what that is kind of saying is this, in the fastest split second we could imagine, will you feel the transformation happen if you are alive here on earth and Christ returns, the trumpet is sounded, and we are called up to him? No, you won't feel it. It'll instantly happen like that. You won't even know what took place. Your body will go from perishable to imperishable. And then the dead will be raised and the church will be called home. All who believe will be caught up, have a new body. This is amazing. So notice how these tie. Verse 50 and verse 53. Will you look there with me? I tell you this, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does perishable inherit imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but in a moment we'll be changed. So notice, put your finger on that word changed. And in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet will sound. For the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised what? Imperishable. So the change takes place where death has now happened, but the consequence of death is what? Being dead, right? The consequence of sin is dying. But notice what is going to happen. The great reversal takes place in that word change. That's why I have you put your finger there. Because the great reversal, so death is going to lose its power. Death is now going to lose its sting. Because why? What was the sting of death? Well, sin. What's the power of sin? The law. That's why Jesus came. But notice what's going to happen. You're going to be changed. So even the dead who have felt the sting of death, the dead And the power of death is going to be reversed because life will come from the grave. Amen? This is what the change means. The change and the power of sin in this time, in this way, is no longer going to be the Lord over you, if you will, the master over you, but King Jesus, who rules and reigns, will be the ruler, will reign over you. And what is that going to look like? That death is going to be reversed in your life. So you will be raised from the dead. You'll be given new life. That's what that looks like. So notice, it says, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we shall all be changed. So those who are alive on earth will be changed in that moment. Changed to what? Imperishable. Why? Because what is perishable cannot inherit imperishable. So the dead must be changed. They must resurrect, and those who are alive must be changed. Both changing to be imperishable. So when we're all given bodies, our bodies will match our souls. Our souls are eternal. Our bodies will then be eternal. And that is exactly what this is talking about. But the sting of death will be removed when the last trumpet sounds. There are two points, at least in the Old Testament, when God tells his people to blow a trumpet to summons the people of God. But Mount Sinai, Moses was told to blow this trumpet, and all of God's people then were summoned around and got to see the glory of God revealed, demonstrated. It's as though in this section, God or an archangel is blowing the trumpet to then summons, if you will, God's people. And the resurrection of the dead takes place. It's a pretty beautiful thing to think about. Pretty beautiful thing to see. So the first reality is this: you cannot earn heaven. The second reality is this: to enter heaven, you must be changed. And now the third reality is this: your changed body displays Jesus' power. This is verses 54 through 57. Your changed body displays Jesus' power. 54 says this: when the perishable, so that's our bodies right now, puts on imperishable, so what it will be our resurrected body, and the mortal, our body right now, puts on what? Immortality, eternal life. Then shall come to pass the saying that is written: death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? We have a little bit of theology here, verses 56 to 57. The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So what do we have here? We have, Paul is first quoting from the Old Testament, but what we also have here is this. Notice what Paul is saying. And what I really want to hone in on is this, because I think this is going to have an impact on not only how you live today, but how you handle funerals. Let's look slowly at verse 54. When the perishable puts on imperishable. I would say the key word there is when. And the mortal puts on immortality. Then the next key word is then. Why are those the key words? The when and the then. Then shall come to pass what is written. Because can I tell you something? Are we saying today, right now, death is swallowed up in victory? We say that about Jesus, do we not? Because Jesus on the cross did it all. All to him we owe. He died on the cross, but because he lived a perfect sinless life, he paid for our sin, but because he was sinless, death could not hold him. He paid for sin, he rose from the dead, and he's seated at the right hand of God. But can I tell you something? We still die today. So because we die today, we're still living in the already but not yet. We're waiting for Christ's return, but death still has victory today. Death still has power today, and it robs, does it not? We have a lady in our church. Her name is Miss Katie. She's 106 years old, which is remarkable. She has been a widow longer than I've been alive. I'm going to say that one more time because I don't know if everybody caught it. She has been a widow longer than I have been alive. She chose to never remarry. Death robbed her of my lifetime of togetherness with her husband. Think about that. Death has robbed her of my entire lifetime with her husband here on earth. Death robs us. Death is not great. Death is terrible. Death touches every one of our homes. Someone in our life, whether they lived a long time or if you've had a miscarriage, death knows no boundaries, steps in and invades each of us. So in this moment, because of Jesus, we have victory, but death still rules today. So this right here, death is swallowed up in victory, will be chanted. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? We are still living with the sting of death because we die. But here's the beauty, and here's really what I want us to see. What did Jesus do on the cross for you? He died. But think about it this way. Jesus on the cross, he took the bee sting of death. So the stinger stuck in Jesus. Is that bee still flying around? Is death still lording over people? Yes. But for those who believe in Jesus Christ, that sting of eternal death, that eternal punishment, will not sting you for all eternity. Why? Because Jesus took your sting. And grace be to God, he's going to then raise you from the dead and you will have life everlasting. That sting of death is going to be removed. So then at one point in the future, verse 54, when this happens, then we will say this, then this will come to pass. At the time when we get our new bodies, then at that point, at that time, we will all chant, whether it's in our lifetime or in the future, we will all chant, all who believe in Jesus Christ, death is swallowed up in victory. Why? Because Jesus took the sting for you. Oh, death, where is your victory? Because Jesus defeated death. Oh, death, where is your sting? Because Jesus conquered not only the grave, he conquered Satan and he conquered sin. Why? He did it for you. He did it for you, for you to live eternally with him. That's what heaven is. It's not walking around on clouds. It's not walking around in this, like, I don't know, whatever state people think. Heaven is not, like the Mormons believe, becoming gods. That's what they actually mean, becoming gods. It's not what the Muslims believe and having 70 virgins. No, but what heaven is this. You get to be with God. And if you think, why would I want to go to heaven? It's perfect. It's the best paradise you could ever dream of. Because God is not only all-powerful, he's majestic, he's mighty. And the paradise that you have in your mind of what you think heaven is falls so far short of what God is actually preparing. It says, for those who believe in Jesus Christ, God is preparing, some translations would say a mansion. I would just submit you to say a room. He's preparing for you a room. Don't get hung up on the word mansion. Get hung up on this. If you believe in Jesus Christ, not only do you have an invitation in, do you get through the gates, but he's also preparing a place for you. You're an honored guest. So it's not just entrance into heaven that is the beautiful thing. God's actually, like, he's preparing a room for you. And like our moms prepared rooms for us when we were younger, like he, as our heavenly father, is preparing the best room we've ever seen for us. A place. But if you're here on earth, you don't know your place. You're just really struggling. Can I tell you something? You have a place, and your place is with God. And if you've never had a home where a mom or dad prepares a place for you, your Heavenly Father will prepare a place for you. And if you've struggled with a family, you don't know where your family is, you don't know what your family is doing, and your dad was kind of rude or ugly, or your mom was rude or ugly, and it's been tough. Can I tell you something? By believing in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're adopted into God's family. You're a son and daughter of the Most High God, and you have an entire family, which is the church and all believers. And he won't just let you into heaven. He'll invite you in if you believe in him as your Lord and Savior. And he has a place for you. Lay your head here. Come to me, my child. My yoke is easy and my burden is. So it displays the power of God. And this is the gift, this gift that we are given in Christ Jesus, the resurrected life. What do we do with that? What is the charge? It comes in verse 50. So we've seen you cannot inherit heaven, verse 50. To enter heaven, you must be changed, verses 51 through 53. Your changed body displays the power of God, verses 54 through 57. And you owe everything to Jesus, verse 58. What does verse 58 say? It says this, therefore, so now after all of what has been said for the last 57 verses, Paul just says, therefore, because we have this great gift in Jesus Christ, because we are going to be resurrected from the dead, because we know this is a reality and a truth, because we can continue to place our faith in Jesus on this. My beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. 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 How many of us work and work and work and work and work and feel like we never gain anything? We never get any. Feel like your labor is in vain. Or maybe you work to save up a little bit of money for a down payment on a house, and then something happens, a medical bill or something like that comes in, and it just like crushes that savings. Or maybe you work and work and work to get a house, and then get the house, and then something breaks on the house, and you have the joys of home ownership. Sometimes it feels like our work is in vain. Here on earth. And the reality is that if we are not doing the work of the Lord here on earth, then everything we do is in vain. When I say the name Paul Allen, does anybody know that name? Know that name? So a lot of people got rich in Microsoft. One individual, not just Bill Gates, is Paul Allen. Paul Allen, he passed away recently. He's the former owner of the Seattle Seahawks and the Portland Trail Blazers. Had a lot of money. Got it all from Microsoft. His art collection sold for something to the sense of $150 million. It's either $150 million or $1.5 billion. I think it's $1.5 billion. I'm sorry. $1.5 billion. That's a billion with a B. That's a lot of money. That art collection. So let's think about that. This man passed away. He had cancer. He owned two teams. They're now going to be sold because his family doesn't want them. And he simply spent $1.5 billion on art to do what? When he died, it went where? Away. What is another word that Samuel would say in that moment? Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Everything is perishing underneath the sun. He had it, and great to have it. He couldn't take it with him when he died. So I kind of want to start in this from reverse. Because for every human who has ever lived, we toil and we struggle and we try to work here on earth to do something with our life, build a legacy, build a character, build a family, just do something, you know? But the reality is this, all of us are laboring, and the question is our labor in vain? Or is it not in vain? Well, verse 58 backwards would say this, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. So now we have this little glimpse into eternity, and it says this. It says that you can do something for the Lord, and your work, your toil, your hardship, your struggle, everything that you give yourself to in the Lord is not in vain, which means you're going to receive an eternal reward for your labors. Wow. Any of you guys want an eternal reward? Where moth and rust will not destroy, but rather it's going to continue for all eternity. And we know that our wealth here on earth can be amassed, but we can't take it with us. So why not invest in eternity? So now we know we can now shift our labor to doing the things that the Lord calls us to do. So that's the end of verse 58. So knowing that we should always then start by abounding in the work of the Lord. So some of us think that being a Christian means we go to church on Sundays and Wednesdays. Or previously, Sundays, Sunday nights, Wednesdays. Abounding. When you hear abounding in anything, what do you think of? Always. But that word is in the text. So always abounding means always doing, always investing, always striving, always giving of yourself to do what? The work of the Lord. This means there's no days off in doing the work of the Lord. But you might say, well, what about a Sabbath? On a Sabbath, we still do the work of the Lord. It just looks different. A Sabbath is a rest from your 9-to-5 or daily grind. It's not a rest from doing God's work. What God has given you. Because the reality is, as a parent, specifically as a husband, the work of the Lord in my life is to love my wife as Christ loved the church and to raise my little boys. I can't take a day off from that. 0 days off. To love my neighbors and to love them well and point them to Jesus, I can't call for a time out one day and say, hey, I'm going to just act like a rebel. This is my Sabbath. I can act the fool this day, but you're going to still look at my character and think, man, this guy's great. This guy's a saint. I want to follow that guy. Nope, can't do that. Can't do that at the gym. Can't do that anywhere in my life. But for some reason, we think that we can have an on-again, off-again relationship in doing the work that God has called us to do. God has called us to, he's given us the opportunity to invest eternally. And to invest eternally properly, we always must be about giving ourselves. So what does that look like? Well, what's the word before that? Immovable. Immovable. So one way to do the work of God is to stand upon your convictions. Stand upon your faith. Be immovable. You are a Christian, and that is your identity because Christ defines you. So now the breath you breathe, the life you live, what you do is all filtered through Christ Jesus, your Lord. You're immovable in that. And guess what? That's no matter what society tells you. We're immovable. What did Jesus tell Peter? Stand on that firm foundation. Stand on the foundation of Jesus Christ and Him, that Jesus is Lord. We are to hold to that, be immovable, then be steadfast. Persevere. Be firm. So no matter what comes your way, what must we do? Keep the faith. Trust in Jesus. Trust in God's. Maybe your life doesn't look like what God has, what you thought it would look like, but it looks exactly like what God knew it would look like. Have you ever thought about that? Your life today is not a mistake. You being here this morning is not a mistake. And God knew you would be right here in this moment, in this time, before you were born. I have a very high view of the sovereignty of God. Because if he wasn't sovereign, he wouldn't be God. So you're not here by mistake. You're not here by chance. And the thing that I want you to hear this morning is this. God loves you. And he actually likes you. Maybe your earthly father didn't like you, but your heavenly father does. Maybe your earthly father didn't say, I love you, but your heavenly father is saying today, I love you. And today God is saying, I'm giving you a gift. The best gift I can give you. A new start. It's a new start in your life by placing your faith and trust in. If you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ today, that he's God, he died for you, he rose again, then you believe that he is Lord, the Bible says that you will have life and have life everlasting. The Bible says that you have a new life, a fresh start. So is it possible to hit a reset on your life? It absolutely is. Our God is not only God of second chances, but third chances. And he redeems broken things and makes them new. He redeems broken things and makes them whole. That's my story. Question at hand is, will it be yours? So if you're here today, you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus, know this, you cannot get to heaven by yourself. You must believe in him because you have to be transformed. And that transformation shows the power of God. And what must we as Christians do as we display that power of God to a lost and dying world? We must stand firm. We must be immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord. Because we know that the work in the Lord, that labor, is not in vain. Will you stand with me? If you're here today, if you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, I want to give you the opportunity to specifically respond to that. We've seen in this section of Scripture repeatedly now that we as believers have this great gift of eternal life and a resurrected body. But if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, my prayer for you is that you wouldn't leave this room without being confident in your walk with God, confident in your relationship, confident in your standing before God. Because we're all going to stand before God and he's going to look at us and say, why should I let you into my heaven? And if you started off with anything other than because I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, Jesus will, if you started off with any other, well, I did good works, I did this, I did that, he'll say, get away from me, I never knew you. Well, he's God and he's sovereign, so he knew you. So the real judgment is this. You didn't know him. Because a knowledge of God and a worshiping of God is what we have is the salvation of God. That's why he's made himself known. So do you know God? Do you trust him? Have you given your life? And if you're here today and you're going through some challenges, some trials, some hardships, you need prayer, it'd be my honor to pray for you. If you're here today, you've never been baptized, come on now, it'd be my honor, your pastor, to baptize you. And if you'd like more information on joining our church, come on down. I'd like to get you plugged into a new member class that we're going to be having. Respond as the Lord leads. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you so much for this time that you've given us. We thank you for your word that is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. And I pray that you would move in this time. Lord, we know that we can worship you. We know that we can serve you. But Lord, I know that there are people in this room who are convicted. And conviction is fleeting, O God. So if anyone is convicted, Lord, may they confess before you. Lord, where they're at, the struggles that they're going through, the hardships. But Lord, if there's someone here who does not know you as the Lord and Savior, may today be the day of salvation. May you move boldly and mightily, oh God. For Lord, we need you. Oh, we need you every hour. We need you. Would you invade our hearts, invade our lives, invade our minds. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Respond to the Lord.
How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great.
Our time of worship together today. I've got a few important announcements to let you know about before we head about our way today. First and foremost, as always, you have the opportunity to give tithes and offerings on your way out the door today. Our ushers will be placed at the exits for that. Let's continue to be faithful as a church family to give as the Lord has led us to give. The rest of the announcements that I have this morning, as I go through them, just a reminder, you can view them in our monthly calendar that's available out in the main hallway, as well as the Exchange Weekly that's updated each and every week, so make sure you grab those on your way out. But first and foremost, as we approach the holiday season, things do get a little bit busy, so I'm going to take us through Thanksgiving Day today in terms of announcements. This next weekend, our men's ministry, we're having our axe throwing and grill out this upcoming Saturday. I'm looking forward to that already. That's going to be at the Staten House. If you need the address, you can talk to myself, Pastor John, or to Kenny as well for the address for that. Something to note, there is a sign-up sheet for that out in the hallway, so make sure you sign up if you're planning to attend. That allows us to prepare how much food we need for that event. But also, if you're planning to attend, we want you to, if you are able, to bring a side or an extra dish to go along with the meat. So we're having, I believe, ribs and pulled pork, so it's going to be a good meal. I'm making myself hungry as I announce that, but you're going to want to bring an extra side if you're able. So on that sign-up sheet out there, just write next to your name what you're going to be planning to bring. That, again, helps us prepare of everything that we need. So a side or a drink or anything like that that you want to bring, make sure you sign up for that. Next Sunday, 1 week from today, when we get ready to dismiss our worship service, we're going to head over to the Fellowship Hall and have a Thanksgiving potluck meal together as a church family. The church will be providing ham and turkey for that event, so we'll provide the meat. You guys bring a side or a dessert to go along with that. So all my announcements seem to involve food today, because the next one is also the food pantry. The day after that, on the 21st, is our food pantry. So that's going to be at 3:30 to 5:30 p.m. One thing to note, that weekend, next week after our church potluck, we're going to transition right into setting up for the food pantry. So we'll do that 1 week from today, Sunday afternoon, after we eat some lunch. We'll gather together and serve our community by getting everything together for the food pantry, which, like I said, will be that following day, the 21st, at 3:30. And then lastly, Tuesday, November the 22nd, is going to be our Wednesday on Tuesday night of praise. If you're new to our church or you've never heard about that before, normally the week of Thanksgiving, we gather together as a church body. We take that Wednesday off to give our congregation the opportunity to spend time with family, but we instead gather on that Tuesday evening. And each year we gather together and we spend time praising the Lord through song and through psalms. And we're going to be doing that again this year. That's going to be Tuesday, November the 22nd at 6 o'clock. That will take place in the chapel. So we will gather together as adults, children, and students will all be together as one that evening and celebrate what the Lord is doing in our church together and praise him in worship and song. This time, I'll turn it over to Pastor John.
And another announcement that we have is on December 4th. That hurt? Sorry. December 4th, we are going to be ordaining and licensing this guy right here. And so we'll be doing that at 5 p.m., so it'll be an evening service. So mark off your calendars, December 4th, 5 p.m., here at Exchange. It's going to be the place to be because we want to not only honor Preston, but we are acknowledging the call that God has placed upon his life to do the ministry that he not only has been doing, but he's going to do the rest of his life. And so this is fantastic. This is a great opportunity, not only for Preston, but for our church. And we want to truly celebrate him and really just honor him and Ashley for all that they have been doing, specifically in our youth ministry and also the worship ministry over the past 4 years and all that God is going to accomplish in the years ahead. So December 4th, please mark that off on your calendars, 5 p.m. Be here at the church, and it'll be a really special service, and God is continuing to build that, which is fantastic. And so I just wanted to make that announcement, and then Preston can close us out.
Thank you, John. That didn't hurt too bad. It wasn't. I exaggerated that just a little bit. But if you would, let's close our service this morning. Let's stand together as one church body, and we will dismiss in prayer today. Would you pray with me? Lord, we are so grateful for who you are, and we're thankful for this day of worship that we have had in you. And Lord, we praise you for what you're going to continue to do in our church. And as we go today, may we live in the power of the resurrection, displaying your goodness, your kindness to those around us. And Lord, would you give us a desire, a passion to share your love and to share the gospel with those around us. Lord, that's our prayer. Be with us as we go. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon, everybody.